alive.
And good morning and welcome to the sunrise safari, and quite the dramatic sunrise it is on this glorious Friday morning out here in the African bush. Quite spectacular. Good morning. Yes, my name is Jamie and I have VM on camera with me this morning. Heading out on Wendy will be Brent along with Jandre, and then Steph and Dave and Herbert will be wandering about on foot looking for whatever small little wonders of the bush they can find. We are coming to you live from Jupiter Plains Game Reserves in the Sabi Sands in the Greater Kruger National Park area of South Africa. So right up in the top of the northeastern corner of this beautiful country. And not only are we live, but we're also interactive, which means you can send through your questions on hashtag SafariLive on Twitter, or you can email them through to questions@wildearth.tv. And I think before we head off, we'll take one last look at this beautiful sunrise. It's because it really is quite spectacular. Thank you to the cloud cover, because it's not even that cold this morning. It's around 14 degrees centigrade, so in the mid-50s Fahrenheit. Not quite as chilly as it has been the last few mornings that we've set off. I've still got my hot water bottle though, tucked in my jackets, just to keep us warm away from the, shelter us a little bit from the wind chill factor. And off we go. We'll be heading across to Cheetah Plains, hopefully. You never know, we might find a pangolin. It has happened before. But while we do that, Brent has found a jackal for you.
I don't know. Look at this, we've got a beautiful little pair of side-striped jackal before the sun is even up. And they're all foraging. Let's just try and move forward and get a last look at them. Morning, my name is Brent Leo Smith. This is Safari Live, and we've started off with one of the rarer little predators we get here at Juma. And they have disappeared into the thicket. But really great. So I think just we saw some very interesting behavior. A bit of hissing at each other, a bit of growling. I think this could be the formation of a new pair. And that will be wonderful, because they do stay in an area quite a lot. So they're likely to stay here around Sandy Patch. Oh, come on guys, pop out for another visit. There's that duiker. A little antelope just ran off there. There he goes across the road. We're not going to put the lights on him. So we heard lions up to this northern area, in this northern area last night. So we're coming to check, see if there are any tracks on the boundary. And I have Jandre Herding on camera with me today, and we're hoping to show you the wonders of the African bushveld. And it's quite chilly, but it looks like we're going to have a spectacular sunrise today. You can see it starting to form. We will show you a closer look of it once we get to the top of the hill, and we can look to east.
Oh dear, it seems as though Brent has disappeared off your screens once again. Wendy's still struggling every now and then with signal. Never fear, you are back of the vehicle with us in safe and capable hands, hopefully. And while you were with Brent, VM and myself were actually just discussing the various bird species out here. Our signal is also a little bit shaky. Thank you.
Sorry about this, everybody. Perhaps something has pushed over the gauri repeater, just like the elephants have pushed over this marula tree. Our technical team is rushing around madly trying to fix it, and we'll be back with you as soon as we can.
Hi everyone, we are experiencing technical difficulties, but please bear with us. Our engineering department and our tech department will be working on getting us back up and running as quickly as possible. As you know, bringing you live safaris from the middle of the African bush is not always the easiest task in the world, but we will be back up, and stick with us because you never know what might be on your screen when we return to you.
So unfortunately, we experienced some tech difficulties. That's one of the things about being live and in the bush, but our tech crew is on it and not asleep like the lions behind me. Hopefully we'll be back with you shortly.
Sorry about this, everybody. Perhaps something has pushed over the gauri repeater, just like the elephants have pushed over this marula tree. Our technical team is rushing around madly trying to fix it, and we'll be back with you as soon as we can.
Hi everyone, we are experiencing technical difficulties, but please bear with us. Our engineering department and our tech department will be working on getting us back up and running as quickly as possible. As you know, bringing you live safaris from the middle of the African bush is not always the easiest task in the world, but we will be back up, and stick with us because you never know what might be on your screen when we return to you.
So unfortunately, we experienced some tech difficulties. That's one of the things about being alive and in the bush, but our tech crew is on it and not asleep like the lions behind me. Hopefully we'll be back with you shortly.
Sorry about this, everybody. Perhaps something has pushed over the Gowrie repeater, just like the elephants have pushed over this marula tree. Our technical team is rushing around madly trying to fix it, and we'll be back with you as soon as we can.
Hi everyone, we are experiencing technical difficulties, but please bear with us. Our engineering department and our tech department will be working on getting us back up and running as quickly as possible. As you know, bringing you live safaris from the middle of the African bush is not always the easiest task in the world, but we will be back up, and stick with us because you never know what might be on your screen when we return to you.
So unfortunately, we experienced some tech difficulties. That's one of the things about being alive and in the bush, but our tech crew is on it and not asleep like the lions behind me. Hopefully we'll be back with you shortly.
Sorry about this, everybody. Perhaps something has pushed over the Gowrie repeater, just like the elephants have pushed over this marula tree. Our technical team is rushing around madly trying to fix it, and we'll be back with you as soon as we can.
Hi everyone, we are experiencing technical difficulties, but please bear with us. Our engineering department and our tech department will be working on getting us back up and running as quickly as possible. As you know, bringing you live safaris from the middle of the African bush is not always the easiest task in the world, but we will be back up, and stick with us because you never know what might be on your screen when we return to you.
So unfortunately, we experienced some tech difficulties. That's one of the things about being live and in the bush. But our tech crew is on it and not asleep, like the lions behind me. Hopefully, we'll be back with you shortly.
Sorry about this, everybody. Perhaps something has pushed over the Gowrie repeater, just like the elephants have pushed over this marula tree. Our technical team is rushing around madly trying to fix it, and we'll be back with you as soon as we can.
Hi everyone, we are experiencing technical difficulties, but please bear with us. Our engineering department and our tech department will be working on getting us back up and running as quickly as possible. As you know, bringing you live safaris from the middle of the African bush is not always the easiest task in the world, but we will be back up, and stick with us because you never know what might be on your screen when we return to you.
So unfortunately, we experienced some tech difficulties. That's one of the things about being live and in the bush. But our tech crew is on it and not asleep, like the lions behind me. Hopefully, we'll be back with you shortly.
Sorry about this, everybody. Perhaps something has pushed over the Gowrie repeater, just like the elephants have pushed over this marula tree. Our technical team is rushing around madly trying to fix it, and we'll be back with you as soon as we can.
Hi everyone, we are experiencing technical difficulties, but please bear with us. Our engineering department and our tech department will be working on getting us back up and running as quickly as possible. As you know, bringing you live safaris from the middle of the African bush is not always the easiest task in the world, but we will be back up, and stick with us because you never know what might be on your screen when we return to you.
So unfortunately, we experienced some tech difficulties. That's one of the things about being alive and in the bush, but our tech crew is on it and not asleep like the lions behind me. Hopefully we'll be back with you shortly.
Welcome back. Sorry about all the tech problems. The gremlins are out on force on this morning. But I did say we're going to have a particularly pretty sunrise. And here we go. Jandro's going to show it to you now. I'm just going to move the car a little bit. Don't have an aerial in your sunrise. Look at that. Isn't that just gorgeous? You can see how fast some of those clouds are moving. Sometimes just wonderful to take a moment's silence at the breaking of the dawn. Now, coming up behind that beautiful sunrise is possibly a little bit more ominous. And if we swing to the right slightly, there's a large bank that looks like it's heading straight for us. We are sort of in this calm before the storm. Not sure if it's going to storm, but I definitely think it might bring some more overcast weather. Apparently there's a big cold front coming in off the eastern seaboard. And I think this is the beginning of it pushing through. The good thing about sitting and looking at the sunrise is it gives you a chance to listen for any of the big cats. Unfortunately, none are making any noise at the moment. We're going to continue our search for the big cats of Africa, and while we do that, it looks like Jamie's gremlins are sorted, so let's jump on board and see what she's up to.
Oh, unfortunately, our gremlins are not entirely sorted, which means that whilst we will, of course, be looking for the big cats, we will be looking in a very limited area for now. And that, never know. There's no reason why they couldn't be coming around to the Vuyatela Dam. At the moment, though, the only large heartbeat that's about is this buffalo bull. We've seen him relatively regularly. I think he might be the buffalo with the injury on his shoulder that has healed up really nicely. It's on his right shoulder, so I can't see at the moment. When we first started seeing him a couple of months ago, he had an enormous hole right around the back of his shoulder blade that the ox pickers just kept worrying at. Oh, maybe it's not him. Looked like it might be him. I only ever recognized him thanks to that shoulder injury. The ox pickers seem to be clustered around that particular spot. And he is enjoying his morning breakfast. Generally, the ruminants will get as much munching in as they can in the early morning. Oh, apparently the sound coming from the microphone is quite low. My microphone is all fine. It seems to be absolutely working perfectly, so not sure what's going on there. It seems to be a morning full of gremlins. Hopefully we will be able to, at least the tech team will be able to bat them away. Okay, let me just think for a second about where I can go. Let's have one more look at our buffalo bull. Not the one with the injury. Hello, boy. Full of the typical bald spots around the face that most old Dugger boys have, and quite a few of the younger breeding herd cows and youngsters will also have. There's a couple of reasons behind them. One is just from the rubbing of the preorbital glands, so scent marking. The other is that buffalo are often prone to different types of skin disease, whether it be through fungal infections or through mange. Oh, and there we've got a sudden, sudden arrival of several oxpeckers. The juvenile immediate, or two juveniles, very clear, with their black bulls as opposed to the red bulls and their dark eyes. Very, very easy to spot a juvenile oxpecker. One in front starting to get the yellow eye. At the moment they're still doing what baby birds do best, which is begging from their parents, despite the fact that at this point they are relatively capable of finding their own food. They fledge in about a month or so. They go from newborn, newly hatched, right up to fully grown. There's an adult oxpecker for good comparison. Nice opportunity to just look at the way that their claws, first of all, manage to hold them at such peculiar angles. And then the stiffened tail feathers keep them upright, or help to keep them upright. And gently furrowing into the patches of skin that are most vulnerable to ticks. You see all the flies buzzing around as well. So despite the fact that winter is here, hasn't quite got to the point that the flies have disappeared just yet. Every now and then it just tickles ever so slightly. The buffalo shifts his skin. I was hoping that the juveniles might be a bit more inclined towards begging. At the moment, they're focused on grooming themselves. Basically, the order of the day The plan for the day in an oxpecker's life is to wake up, leave their nesting sites in dead trees and holes in trees, head out, find a host, and then pretty much spend the rest of the day traveling between that animal and to water. Because if you eat 1,000 ticks a day, that is a lot of blood and a lot of salt, and it makes oxpeckers very water-dependent birds. They need to sort of constantly travel backwards and forwards to drink. But if each oxpecker can eat 1,000 ticks, then if we've got 5 of them on here, that's 5,000 ticks, 6,000 ticks, give or take. Maybe let's not count the juveniles to be quite that high. So let's say there's 4,000 ticks that will be removed today just by the group of red-billed oxpeckers that we have here. I'm sure the buffalo will be exceptionally grateful for that service paid to him. And then, as always, the ubiquitous fork-tailed drongo, a little black bird that accompanies such large animal sightings, very commonly seen around any of the big animals because they disturb insects. And in turn, the fork-tailed drongo can flutter down and catch them. It's not very hard to see where the first part of the name came from, is it? And Kimberline has said that oxpeckers must have life pretty good. They've got an endless supply of food, because yes, certainly there will be an endless supply of ticks. Constant transport. No need to exercise. And certainly that very much seems to be the case as they flutter about their host. The only thing they've really got to watch out for is an irritated animal trying to swish their heads at them or flick their ears. One of the big reasons why they tend to focus around the neck and the leg area is that is where the ticks are. The worst of the tick infestations, of course, are in the most sensitive of the buffalo's areas. The difference there, of course, is that generally buffalo bulls tend, and most animals, tend not to be terribly tolerant of their attentions if they're focused around between their back legs. I think it's particularly uncomfortable for them. That's why that's always where the animals have the most ticks, and why generally you see the oxpeckers working around different areas. Look at his milky eye. I've seen a lot of buffalo with cataracts or with developing cataracts. Not necessarily that is the case here, but it does look a little bit, it doesn't look very clear. There's definitely a blue tinge to it. And I sometimes wonder if that's not caused by impact with each other when they fight. Knocking their skulls together, the base of those really thick horns. He looks terribly confused. He doesn't quite know what to do. Shall we leave you, boy, so you can decide where you want to be? The good news is that whilst Brent and myself are beset by gremlins, there is a third party out this morning. Let's head over to Steph so that he can say hello.
Well, good morning to this morning's bushwalk, and have a look at how majestic that looks. It's another cloudy day today. It's not that cold. It's not as cold as it was yesterday. It's only about 40 or 50 degrees Fahrenheit at the moment, so it's not too bad. Have a look at the sun coming up over there. I'm Stefan Winterboer, and we're on camera with David, but we've got some signal problems, so we're going to send you back over to Jamie while we try and sort out.
It appears as though I spoke somewhat too soon, and that the backpack is also struggling with signal this morning, so bushwalk also battling a little bit in terms of finding a good place to have signal. I apologize, I do just need to listen to the Game Drive channel. Quite a long update, my apologies, but I do just need to listen to this. Andrew, sorry, what was it, CP open? Copy that. Thanks, Andrew. Good morning. We'll head there a bit later. Sorry about that, guys. I just needed to chat to Andrew. So basically, with our game drive communications, there's several vehicles out at any one point in time during the early morning and the afternoon. And what that means for us is that we try and communicate and make sure that we share as much of what's going on around us as possible. And Taxon just wants to chat to me now, so let me just hear what he wants to tell me. Go ahead, Tax. Morning, Tax. We're having problems with the movers, but I think hopefully I'm going to be heading to Cheetah Plains. I'm not sure where Brent's working. Basically, what Taxon was trying to ask me was where I'm going to be working this morning so that we don't cover the same areas of ground. Since I couldn't tell him where Brent was wondering about, let's find out from Brent himself what his plans are for the morning.
So we've given the sun time to rise by itself, and now we're looking for whatever creatures might be out here on the eastern front of Juma Private Game Reserve. And it's a bit quiet at the moment, and it's actually getting colder as that big cold front seems to get closer. But on a positive note, the cool weather could keep the cats moving a little longer. So this is an area we often find lion and leopard tracks. So we always want to check it extra carefully. And nothing today. Sarah Wood said she missed the Facebook Live catch-up last night. Was there a pangolin dance? We decided to hold the pangolin dance, and Dave and I are going to do a little more complicated video on the pangolin dance. So look up.
And you're back on Rusty once again. We are struggling to find areas this morning where we have good signal. I'm going to try and get to Cheetah Plains, but it's going to be particularly tricky if we're the only vehicle that's out, because it means that we have to go through several dips before we get there. We just have to keep our fingers crossed that the Gowrie mast does decide to come back up. And again, I'm sorry, you jumped on the back exactly when I need to talk on the Game Drive channel. It's just Steph telling us that there are zebra alarm calling around in Impala Plains in that area. We're gonna try and head across there rather. Trying to decide what's going to be best in terms of where we can take you so that you still have picture and not us on tech loop. we had a sighting of the oxpeckers earlier that we chatted about on the back of the buffalo. Justin, you were wondering, do eagles and hawks and such things ever swoop down oxpeckers, since they seem like they would be really easy targets? And it's not something I've ever experienced. Now, typically, the bird of prey that would target an oxpecker would be something like a goshawk. Those sorts of birds, shikras, goshawks, that's the sort of the right size and speed. Otherwise, surprisingly, an oxpecker is relatively nimble when they have to be in terms of escaping away from birds of prey. I've never seen it, Justin. I don't know whether any of the other presenters have. It does, I can understand what you're saying. It seems like it would be a relatively easy way of grabbing something, but perhaps the presence of such a large animal with the oxpeckers is enough to intimidate the bird of prey. Perhaps that landing, you know, ambushing birds, when a bird of prey does that, a raptor does that, what they generally do is they come at high speed and they bash the bird concerned into the ground. Now they couldn't, it would be very tricky for them to pluck them off the back of an animal and not run the risk of that big animal changing direction or injuring themselves in some way. So maybe that's why they don't do it. I've never seen it. All right, over to Brent, something exciting.
Just seen a honey badger go off the road here, and he was scuttling off not too fast, so we're just moving very slowly. So he wasn't running, he wasn't disturbed yet. There's a whole myriad of little holes and stuff in there. It's an old aardvark den, and he might have gone to inspect.
It seems as though Brent really struggling for signal this morning. How lucky has he been? A pangolin and a honey badger sighting in 2 days, in two consecutive drives. We have been extraordinarily lucky with the small and nocturnal animal sightings, the more unusual of animals to see out here. We've had African wildcat, we've had pangolin. All right, he's got signal again. Back to Brent.
So we found the honey badger. It just went down one of those holes. And with Jean-Rez, you see that little bit of red soil to the right of the tree. He should pop out again now. He's going to move forward slightly to hopefully catch him as he comes out of that hole. Or her. I haven't actually had a good enough look to decide whether it's a male or female. How's that, Jandre? So you see that little patch of red sand there? There's a hole there that the honey badger has disappeared into. And hopefully it's going to be coming out any second now, unless it's found something good to eat down there. And it is incredible, these winter, this dry season, we are going to get some incredible sightings of stuff we don't see too much of. Firstly, because it's dry and there's food pressure. Secondly, because there's very little grass for them to hide behind. Come on, Mr. Honey Badger, out of the hole now. Or Miss Honey Badger. Patience game. Come on, honey badger. there's a possibility might be denning there. Unlikely. More than likely, it's just gone down to see if it can get something to eat. Making us play the patience game. Chandra's at the ready. I've got my camera in my lap. We're sitting here. Could have found something nice to eat down there. As I said, it could also be denning or sleeping there. But it didn't look like it. It definitely looked, while we watched it moving, like it was on the forage. So I don't want to turn away from the whole, but Chandra is watching over my shoulder. But so, believe it or not, we've actually had a real serious little carnival morning. So unfortunately, while we're having tech difficulties, we actually saw two African civets. We've seen two side-striped jackals to start, and now we've seen a honey badger, and we really hope we're going to get to show you the honey badger if it decides to come out of this hole it's gone into. Now, the problem is sometimes these holes have multiple exits. I'm just trying to make sure it doesn't come out of another hole. Well, Katrina says we've had way too many good sightings recently. We've been spoilt, so the gremlins decided they need to have a little say in what's going on. Let's try. I'm just going to try have a look if we are in the exact best position while he's still under the ground there. So I want to also make sure there's no other bolt hole out of that hole. I think we were in the best spot. Janet's wondering, what is a honey badger's diet? Well, Janet, it's a true omnivore, a very mixed diet. It'll eat a lot of little rodents, insects, scorpions, baby birds, birds' eggs, if it can, and even baby scrub hairs, anything it can catch and eat. How's that, Chandra? I'm just saying, just in case, or would you prefer a bit further back? Forward. So you can actually have a look at that very red soil there. Now, that's been dug out. And so I said, it might be using this as a spot to snooze. But just from its general behavior, the way it was moving, I don't think so. Yes, Chandra is laughing. We had such nice visuals of it when we went black screen, and then as soon as we come back, it disappears down a hole. So, Herbert, you're spot on, just as I was saying. They do sleep underground, but I just think that from the way he was moving, it looked more like he was foraging. And they are going to be foraging later. It's also a very cool morning, so they might be foraging throughout the day. In winter, you do see a lot more honey badgers out during the day. How brave am I feeling, Chandra? Brave enough to go have a look? I'm going to go have a look. So if I come yelping and running back towards the car, we all know the honey badger is going to be chasing me. So also, if I go have a look now, what it's going to do is I can see if there's multiple sets of tracks going in there, and if they are seeing it, using it as a den site, which also means it's a really good place to look for them in the early morning. think he's gone to sleep. So he's gone in there, but we definitely have to come check here towards the end of the sunset safari for when he wakes up. But it looks like he's gone to sleep. It's a really deep hole, originally excavated by Aardvark. I'm quite happy it didn't come barreling out towards me, but at least we know. So we're not going to go sit here for the next 3 hours waiting for the honey badger to pop its head. So I'm pretty sure he's gone to sleep in that hole. So hopefully we can find him on the sunset safari. Okay, so while we move and we're going to try to get back towards better signal area, let's go to Jamie, who's got some pachyderms.
On our way to Cheetah Plains, we have come across a wonderful breeding herd of elephant. They are moving about in very thick bush, and they seem to be, the little ones at least, the young elephants seem to be quite unsettled. Can't find a nice view for you. There's a couple of really beautifully large females in that herd. And we are going to have to move out of the way anyway. There's a vehicle that's coming up behind us. So let's shift now while we have the opportunity. We'll see if we can't get a better view of our elephants first thing in the morning from a different angle. Definitely, I keep hearing a car coming up behind me. And just as we get up to this female, have a look at her incredible tusks. Hopefully she decides to show them to us. A big girl. Sorry, Vim, I know I'm putting us at an awkward angle. It just gets us off the road enough or any vehicles to come past. Let's see as she turns. You can see just how beautifully curved her tusks are. Definitely one of the older females in this herd. And the wonderful thing about this camera is that we get such a fantastic perspective on the different parts of an elephant. She's quite an old girl. She's quite thin. Her bones are showing through. Not thin, she's just lost a lot of elasticity in her skin, which means that her bones become more visible and more prominent. She just loses that little bit of subcutaneous fat. There you can see her hip bones and her spine quite prominent. That's much less clear in a younger elephant. Oh, we've got two young bulls here. And have decided to have a little bit of a scrap. Equal sized, but one very much more fortunate in the tusk department than the other. And I think you'll find that that young male probably backs down. Oh, no. Yeah, now he's back down. He just doesn't quite have the tusks to match. Some landscaping happening in the background. You just hear the crunching and the cracking of the trees. I'm sure I recognize this herd. I'm sure that I've seen them before. It's the nice thing about working somewhere for an extended period of time is that you really get to know not just the leopards and the lions, but also the individual elephant herds. One young bull has decided to be comfortable enough. Oh, you lost the fight with the other guy. Are you going to kind of try and come and take it out on us, or are you just interested in whatever's there? Oh, I think you just smelt something nice there. You can hear the beeping happening. That's the VR rig preparing to record. Since we do have a lovely Ellie in close proximity, we're going to be chatting a little bit about that. So, look right in front of us. You can see a young male elephant who is currently shifting the branches away out of his way so that he can get to the plant life underneath it. Give it a good sweep to clear the dust before he puts it into his mouth. Beautiful morning, of course it's not just us that are interested in viewing the elephants. We've got a whole herd all around us. Right across, if you look to the left, you'll see a big female feeding a couple of meters away. Lovely, peaceful sighting. And I think that pretty much draws to a close our virtual reality segment. So I'm just going to clap quickly to sync the sound.
Oh, never mind. One camera dropped out.
Oh, well, never mind. VM says one camera dropped out. So everything's beset by gremlins. Good morning.
Good morning.
This is going very well.
Hi, guys.
Hi, Jandre.
Yeah.
Hey, VM.
What's up?
How are you doing?
Good, yeah.
Nice elephants.
Yes, lovely elephants. We're going to try and get to...
Did you hear that update from Andrew?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, if you want to keep moving, we're happy to look after the elephants for you.
Will you take care of our elephants?
We'll take care of them.
Make sure
they behave themselves.
Have you got signals
here? I don't know. Do you have signals here?
That's probably the first question one should ask.
Yes, at this point. We'll keep looking at the elephants for now while we work out whether or not Brent and I can swap around so that I can get to the plane.
Yeah,
I don't know, Brent. You could have, actually.
I'm not sure.
On
every time we moved 5 meters, we lost signal, and unfortunately, that failure went down a hole.
Okay. Apparently, we have strong signal.
You have strong signal.
We have strong signal, so we'll stick with our elephants.
Okay,
and we'll
keep moving back towards camping.
Yeah. All right, good luck.
Okay.
Cheers.
Bye, guys.
Bye. We're going to stay with our Ellies for now and just see what they're up to. There are things to look for on cheetah plains, but we've got a lovely herd of elephants for now. Look at that delicate mouthful she's just taken. Really concentrated quite hard on chewing that. Now, the reason she's doing that, it could well be, is that she might be grinding down one set, or has ground down her final set of teeth. I don't think she's quite that old, but essentially an elephant is given 6 sets of teeth in its life, and those are replaced regularly throughout its 60 odd years, 50 to 60 odd years of life. And an elephant actually starts to lose condition when they get to that 6th set of molars. You can imagine what kind of impact constant eating has on their teeth. Constant eating, and it's not exactly like it's soft custard and jello. It's serious food that they're crunching on. Just imagine how that grinds down their teeth. I think that's why this female is eating as carefully as she was just now. I think that her teeth have been worn down, and she may well not have the next set to replace them. She might be on her final set of teeth. As she gets older and as she starts to struggle more and more, she'll start moving towards the riverbeds and the places where there's soft food. At the moment, monkey orange definitely isn't the easiest food for an elephant, even an elephant, to eat. First of all, it's not very nice, and second of all, it's distinctly uncomfortable. It's very hard wood and very spiny wood. She'll move to areas away from her herd when she can no longer keep up with them, to rivers where the food and the reeds are nice and soft. And that in turn is actually what's led to this myth of elephant graveyards. It's because old elephants that die of natural causes, a lot of them congregate around rivers because the food is soft, and eventually they just can't sustain themselves anymore, and they lose condition to the point that one of the conditions of old age will cause their death. And then there's a big flood that washes the bones downriver, and they all collect in one place. We have a question about an elephant's nutritional needs. It's actually something we spoke about yesterday. So Herbert says, you were wondering about how does an elephant get the calcium that it needs to maintain such large bones? And the answer is there's a lot of calcium in the plant food that they eat. They will also practice what's known as geophagy, in places where they will eat rock or lick at salt in order to get their mineral needs. And there will be calcium in some of the salt areas. And then we spoke about this yesterday. One of the viewers asked us a question on our Facebook Live after drive as to whether or not we have ever seen elephants eat bones. And both Brent and myself said no, but Steph said that he has seen them eat bones before. I've seen them put them into their mouths once or twice, almost like it's out of curiosity, but I haven't seen them chew on them and nibble on them in the same way that I've seen Nyala and giraffe do. But that practice is known as osteophagy. So, like geophagy, just osteo, bones. And I'll munch on those, and that will supply them with their calcium needs. Look at that little hole in her ear. Perfect little piercing. Something to that gentle walk of an elephant that is so peaceful to watch as the pads of their feet stretch out. Let's try repositioning, but most of our herd has moved off into the thick bush. Welcome to the Sunrise Safari. As always, we've been looking at the tusks of some of the elephants, and of course our lovely lady here is not the best example of what it is you're talking about, but we'll try and get a nice view of her anyway, just because she's been so obliging. You have to wonder what an elephant like this has seen in her life. Let me try to get ahead of her ever so slightly. Georgianne has been observing the tusk growth of the elephants out here, and has said that she's noticed that some of the elephant tusks grow downwards in the manner of the forest elephants. I was wondering whether or not there's a chance that they have crossbred. There's always a chance in nature, of course, but it's highly, highly unlikely. South Africa has a very small population of what have been classified as forest elephants towards the Tsitsikamma region and the Eastern Cape. Eastern is sort of northern part of the Western Cape along the coast. And it's a very, very isolated population. Now, most of the forest elephants live in Central Africa, the Gabon areas. And I know exactly what you mean when you talk about the shape of those tusks. They've got very straight, very pointy tusks that point directly downwards. I don't think, however, that our elephants have that result. Of course, the forest elephants and savanna elephants are essentially come from the same ancestor. So the genetics that program for those straight downward pointing tusks will be present in the savanna elephants as well. It's just that the environment in which the forest elephants evolved is more favorable, obviously selects for that particular genetic strain, over with the savanna elephants having these pointed, curved tusks that our female has in front of us. Oh, that's not a very nice tree to go and eat, big girl. She's now decided to tackle a sickle bush. Didn't expect her to come forward like this, actually, but there you go. Wandering away from the river. rest of her family. Now, is she going to... Is she still of an age that she is the matriarch in this herd? She's definitely one of the oldest. But I think that she's got to the point that she is so old that the matriarchy has passed on to one of the other elephants. She might never have been the matriarch, of course. But whilst we often say that the matriarch is the oldest elephant in the group, that's not always exactly true. It's definitely one of the older females. But it gets to a point where a matriarch does actually get a little bit too old to be leading a herd, and at which point she'll pass the leadership down either to her daughter or one of her younger sisters, something similar, sort of along those lines. And elephants are so complex that it's impossible for us to put a general rule to it. But she's moved completely away. The rest of the herd is still across to the left. Elaine, we had that beautiful sighting of a close-up of her lower lip, and Elaine was wondering, is there a reason why elephants have so much hair around their lower lips, around their mouth? And yes, if you think about it, think about where an elephant's eyes sit, and then they've got this enormous bulk of their trunk, and then their lower jaw kind of sticks out here. Now, we struggle as it is to see down to below our chin, but we've now got hands and knives and forks, so feeding ourselves is relatively easy. But for them, navigating these thorn trees in a way that they get the branch, put it into their mouth, dodge the bits that they want to dodge, get the bits that they want to eat, is all helped, or the hairs on the end of the mouth actually help to control that. They're sensitive like whiskers, so it allows them a feel of what their mouth is doing rather than necessarily being able to see it. Here comes our young boy again. Here's that idea. It's interesting how the plants have evolved to have big spines and thorns and things that are meant to make them uncomfortable to eat, and the elephants have evolved to completely disregard such things. It's of absolutely no bother to them. Even a young elephant like this little bull, he's the one. If you look at his tusks, he's the one that lost the battle with the other young bull. Well, time to focus on that sickle bush as well. I have many scars from that tree throughout my time in the bush, and yet even a young elephant that you would expect to be slightly more sensitive isn't terribly bothered. Although he's been quite delicate about his consumption of this tree. Just picking away the green leaves. Oh, okay. What was that all about? I'm not sure about all of you out there, but I never ever get tired of watching the way in which an elephant goes about its feeding process. Elephants are never boring to sit and watch. That delicacy of the way in which they move their trunk, wrapping it around the leaves, and the knowledge that that trunk is capable of such power and yet such delicacy at the same time. Just plucking the leaves one by one here, he's totally avoiding the spines of the tree. He's going to cross to find Grandma or Great Aunt or however she happens to be related to him. Just bear with me while we watch this peaceful scene play out. Brent is trying to just get hold of me. Standing by.
Copy that, thanks, Brent. Yeah, we'll make our way there now.
Hey, there's a lovely water buck across the road.
Copy, thanks. Confirm it's controlled on Western Channel. Okay. Things have changed. The plans have changed. And we're heading across to the west instead of the east. I don't want to scare the eddies though, so let's just find a nice turnaround spot. We have exciting news. The Gormas are hunting buffalo on Arethusa. So we're going to head across in that direction. Let's see if we can't join that sighting. We might have to wait for a little bit. Brent has booked us a position on standby one just because he doesn't have signal. So we're going to go and take his place at that sighting. A big thank you to Brent, who's sorted us out. We might not be able to get to Cheetah Plains, but we can get to the Nkuhumas. But you're all going to have to hang on, because we're going to have to Ferrari Safari there, or else we're going to lose our spot at that sighting. When you really feel the brisk bite of the cold morning air. And what it means when I say that I'm on standby, in order to reduce the impact that we have on the animals, there's a restriction to the number of vehicles that can be with an animal at any one point in time. And that number is usually 3. But if a guide sees that it's an extra sensitive area or it's an extra sensitive animal, then that can be dropped to 2 or even to 1 vehicle at a time that gets to see the animal. And it's a very good way of making sure that the animal is not overcrowded during a sighting. So everybody takes their turn, you get to line up and take your place in that queue. We've got the first place to take after somebody leaves. How are you doing back there, VM? Freezing. The excitement. Might not be a leopard, but it's a big cat. Big cat potentially hunting buffalo. And it's been a while since we've seen the Nkuhuma pride. Pride of 5 lionesses, but in this case I think it's safe to say we can expect to see maximum of 4, since one of them has given birth to 3 cubs on Torchwood and is currently denning them there. Exactly where the lions are, I have to get closer in order to find out, but I know that they're somewhere around Triple M. So what boundary of Juma, Gowrie, Maine, and then we're going to, as soon as we get to the corner, we're going to head straight north and start making that direction. So we're speeding along here. There you go, just a little bit of a rough idea as to where it is we're going and what it is we're racing to. I'm just listening as well with half an ear to the Game Drive channel, that I can hear what's happening and where those lionesses are going. It sounds as though there's only 3 of them. And I want wonder if that wasn't what where Steph heard the alarm calls coming from. Maybe they were responsible for scaring those zebra first thing this morning. Ooh. And there's always that feeling of anticipation and excitement. I get to see the Nkumuma lionesses once again. It's been a long time since I've managed to see them. But my hot water bottle's not quite doing its job at this speed. Hunching double in the front. Eyes streaming, nose streaming. And of course, on a morning like this morning with these kind of temperatures, the big cats are going to be moving around for much longer. James Richards, you were wondering, you were saying, you know that the windy cold weather is an advantage to the big predators, but can the same be said for the smaller predators? Will they be more active as well? And the answer is yes, absolutely. It applies across the board to all of the predators and also to most of the nocturnal... Sorry, hyena. Most of the nocturnal species. It was not a hyena, it was a hyena's tracks in the road. But I had to slow down just to check that it was not a leopard track that I was about to obliterate in my high-speed movement. So James, yes, it applies across the board for all predators, but also, as I was saying earlier, it applies to the things like pangolins, aardvarks, honey badgers, all of those animals that are typically nocturnal, even porcupines. Are typically nocturnal. On a cold morning like this morning, they will be more prepared to be active for longer and also come out earlier in the afternoons. One of the reasons why you got to enjoy that pangolin sighting with Brent yesterday afternoon on the sunset safari in the middle of the afternoon. It's one of the reasons why, despite the cold and despite how we moan and shiver, okay, well, I moan and shiver, everybody else is quite stoic about the whole deal. It's one of the reasons why we still absolutely love winter as a season. We've got a far better chance of seeing mysterious animals like that. I'm going to stop and just look at these hornbills because it gives me a chance to just chat on the Game Drive channel. We've arrived right at the corner of Gowrie Main and Cheetah Plains. Right, I must get my radio microphones not confused. Copy that, thanks very much. Standing by on Triple M. Great for Jamie. Brent, I can't copy the lock clearly. I'm standing by on Triple M. I can hear whether or not I get called in, but I can't hear where they are exactly. Copy that, perfect, thank you. Alright, well, we've got to wait our turn now. We're on the right road, we just can't actually go and join just yet. But we're going to hang out and see what else we can find in this general vicinity. It was worth the rush though. They're just over the crest ahead of me. What I'm going to do is I'm going to pop onto Arethusa. We're going to hang out here until it comes time for us to take our place in that sighting.
And of course, no morning would be complete without a cup of South African Milo. I'm not sure. I know I used to be able to get Milo in the UK. I don't know if anybody can get Milo in America. As far as I know, it's a South African drink. Oh, initially, it's of South African origin. And it's a sort of, it's like hot chocolate, but 10 times better. Sorry guys, I have to stop. I have to try and listen to what's happening on this Game Drive channel. Just to make sure that we don't miss when we get called in. And just to keep you updated on what's happening. Justin, as we raced across to this site, and you were wondering, when driving around the game reserve, is there a general agreed upon speed limit? The standard speed limit of most reserves, and this reserve included, is between 30 and 40 kilometers an hour, which converted to miles is, what's that, 30 to 40 is about 12 to about 17 miles per hour. Now, that speed that I did now was close to about, I would say about 30 kilometers an hour, so still very much under the speed limit. But yes, there'll be differences. Like on this kind of road, this is not one of the main access roads. It is a little bit more than a two track. And in that kind of case, you'd be cruising along at about 20 or so, about half the general maximum speed. That being said, there are certain areas where those speed limits are higher, particularly in the Kruger National Park where the roads are tarred. That's generally at around 50, and certain vehicles are exempt from that and can travel up to 60 to 80 kilometers. They can go a bit faster because they work and they have to do things within the park itself, which means you have to cover ground. You don't have a choice. The speed limits are very important. They're there for the animal's safety, they're there for people's safety. And it's something that everybody is very, very conscious of. There's limits to the time of day in which you can be traveling around in the reserve itself, and that is largely for anti-poaching measures. It didn't used to be that way. You could travel through the reserve at any time you like. But for most reserves, first of all, there's a gate closing time, and then second of all, for us at our camp, we have to be home by 10:30 to 11. Sorry, I'm trying to listen with half an ear at the same time. No way. Oh, I thought it was a shop's Facebook for a second. So, yes, there's a curfew for us, and what that means is that the anti-poaching team doesn't have to focus their attentions too much on following up on lights or vehicles moving about at night that then just turn out to be people moving in the dark between lodges or between parties, so that they don't waste their time and their resources. A very large loop around, waiting to be called in. Unfortunately, I can't hear clearly.
But they do have some interesting impala rutting action. No, I know, but I cannot hear the game drop.
Sorry about this, everybody. Perhaps something has pushed over the gauri repeater, just like the elephants have pushed over this marula tree. Our technical team is rushing around madly trying to fix it, and we'll be back with you as soon as we can.